And I'm glad for our sakes that today we know him authentically and genuinely, and that we're not trying to figure this thing out, and there are many who are. But I'm grateful that today I can testify to you that I know him for myself. Yeah, I remember the days when I was growing up and my parents would, particularly my mom, reading scripture to us. She would tell us about the Lord. And somewhere along my journey, I found him for myself. And I am so grateful, so grateful. Jesus asked Peter, asked the disciples, because some of the other inauthentic disciples turned away. They were offended by his teaching and preaching. And you know truth does offend, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
They turned away. They didn't want to hear what he had to say. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Will you also go?" And Peter, in his own style, answered that question. And I trust he answered it for you as well. What was his answer? That's right. To whom shall we go? Is there somebody else? There's no one. He's God alone, beloved. He's God alone. And there are no other options for us. And I thank God for just that knowledge, the knowledge. In fact, one of our memory verses says that the knowledge of God is being diffused, spread, as it were, through us as an aroma. To some, it's an aroma that is death, reminds them of death, leading to death. But I praise God for you and your presence here, to others that are being saved. The knowledge and the aroma of Christ is life, life for us that leads to life.
Amen.
And just so grateful to be here this morning.
We've
been talking about this idea of suffering. And I don't know what possessed me to go after this. I was in prayer this week and on my knees. And I was in my my little study. And it was warm in the room. It was warm in there. And I had already gotten down to pray and started praying. And as I'm praying, I felt the warmth of the air in the room just sort of surrounding me. And I stopped my prayer to turn on the ceiling fan. What am I talking about? Suffering. I didn't want to suffer heat in my prayer. I needed the comfort of the fan in order to pray to God. Now, before you call me some type of heathen, probably should, but consider how we run the worship of God through the grid of our own comfort and convenience when it's convenient, when it's comfortable. And just let me say it, I suspect that if the air was not on, I suspect if you knew next week that we would not have air conditioning, you probably would go to maybe that big church over there where you know they've got some air. What am I talking about? I'm talking about what? This idea of suffering. And we do it without a sense of, I know I do. I've been doing it without a sense of even thinking about it. It's just second nature. Amen. I want to worship God in comfort and ease.
Yes, sir.
And not realizing that in my own heart, it's a perverted worship.
Yes.
Because I need the comfort.
Yes, sir.
In order to worship Him. I'm just sharing with you, beloved, just some thoughts about this idea of suffering and just how deeply embedded our resistance to it. It's so deeply embedded in our psyche.
Yes, sir.
This idea of avoiding suffering at all cost. Our culture doesn't help us at all in this regard. But suffering is important to God. And so when we're talking about, we've been talking about the idea of suffering, and for those of you who perhaps aren't aware, but we've been looking at the idea of suffering as part of this paradigm, I guess, paradigm of what it takes to get back to devotion to Jesus Christ as the singular sufficient and God who has supremacy over our lives. How do we get back? Because he told the Ephesus church that they what? It left their first love. And it leads to this question. He tells them, I want you to remember from where you've fallen. I want you to repent, and I want you to return.
Amen.
And that idea of returning, it begs this question, how do we return to Jesus Christ? And so this series has gone far beyond what I initially anticipated, but I serve at his behest. I'm here because this is what he does. This is what he wants me to do. And I thank you for giving me the privilege of serving you in this regard and with the Word of God. I can't think of another greater privilege than to be able to open the Word of God and share it with the people of God. Thank you for that. But this idea of getting back to Jesus Christ in deep, intimate, authentic devotion, it requires, as we stated, those of you who've been here for some time, you know it takes, and here's a pop-up test, those of you who've been with us, what's the first thing that it takes to love Jesus? Okay, now let me help you. Maybe I just left you out there without a life raft, but let me throw you a life preserver. I'm talking about this paradigm that I set out for you, our way of getting back. Let me give you a hint. The first word is seeking. You remember that? You remember? That you can't love Jesus unless you're what? You can't love him if you don't seek him. Then there was a second. What's the second one? Sacrifice. You can't love Jesus Christ without sacrifice. That's just so obvious. It's just so clear that loving him requires you and I perpetually seeking him, perpetually sacrificing that our lives are for him as an aroma, a sweet smell. We sacrifice our lives on behalf of Jesus Christ. It's giving away what he's given to us. And then third brings us to this idea of suffering, that and sacrifice and suffering essentially go hand in hand. In fact, all of these are interrelated, that you seek, you sacrifice, you suffer, and it sort of builds and cascades to this crescendo upward. What? Seeking, sacrificing, suffering, sanctification, satisfaction, serving, speaking. It's just a natural flow that Spirit of God, I believe, wants to build into us. Jesus said it, return. This, I believe, is how we get back. We've been talking about the idea, again, of suffering as this third step in making our way back to Jesus Christ. And I hope that each of you has. Each of you has. Thank you, English teacher. Each of you has a copy of the passages on suffering. Everyone have that? No? If you don't have, stick your hand up. Brother Charles, no, ran out again. Oh, wow, man. Okay, so can we get some more copies, would you? I want to make sure you get those. I just found it remarkable. I was really just sort of winging my way through the New Testament looking for passages that speak about this idea of suffering. Wanted to make sure that I'm not just creating some notion that can't be supported with Scripture. And throughout the New Testament, that's what these verses, I think it's 24 verses throughout the New Testament that testify to this idea of suffering for Christ. And it's just amazing that suffering is on the mind of God.
Amen.
That too is a eye-opener.
Yes.
That he intends for us to suffer.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I didn't expect. You did not let me down. You didn't let me down. I didn't expect a lot of amens on that one.
Amen.
But he does. He does. We have an amazing Father. And he uses suffering. In fact, I want to read this. C.S. Lewis, great writer from the early part, mid part of the 19th century. Listen to this. A great, great writer. Came to faith in Christ, but he's just a wonderful thinker. I want to read a couple of captions from his book called The Problem of Pain, and it really gets into the idea of suffering, the problem of pain. This is what one thing he says. The surrender of self-will, which is inflamed and swollen with years of usurpation, is a kind of death. Now let me tell you what he's saying. He's saying that our self-will, what gets in the way of you loving God? Self. You and me, our biggest enemy is not him, her, it, they made me do. No, the biggest problem in terms of pursuing Jesus Christ is self. And he calls it the self-will. He says the self-will is inflamed. I love the language. The self-will is inflamed and swollen with years of usurpation. What does it mean to usurp? To usurp means to take what's not yours. It's like, I think in Peter, it says that the woman should not usurp what? Authority. See, authority, leadership in the home and in the church belongs to the man. This is God ordained. And when a woman takes on authority, pastoral roles and things of that nature, she's what? Usurping, taking what is not hers by design. Well, to usurp the self-will, C.S. Lewis says, our self-will has been inflamed and swollen with years of usurping. Does that sound like you? Okay, maybe not. But I've got that problem. I see it. Listen to this. The human spirit will not even begin to try to surrender self-will as long as all seems to be well. What did he say? The human spirit, self-will will not even begin to try to surrender that self-will as long as everything seems to be well.
Amen.
And I said earlier that God wants us to what? He does. And what is he doing with suffering? See, he's taking back authority over your life, my life. We have usurped his authority in our lives by way of sin. And suffering is God's way of taking back authority, getting our attention. In fact, one last quote from C.S. Lewis. This is good. And I'll move on. God whispers to us in our pleasure. You know, when things are going well, it's God whispering, I love you, I care for you. And he speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pain. Pain is his megaphone to rouse, to awaken a deaf world. Incredible thinking. God uses pain to awaken deafness, to get our attention. And it started way back in the garden. Adam and Eve sinned. And what did God do? What was his immediate response? What did he do? He brought pain into their experience. Adam had to suffer pain in fallowing the ground, because now the ground is going to resist him where it would automatically grow. But now he's got to work it. He's got to till it. The woman was going to suffer pain in childbirth. They sought pleasure in eating the fruit and only brought what? Pain. Isn't that amazing? It's amazing. To pursue pleasure at God's expense will definitely bring you pain.
Amen.
Oh, you can take that one to the bank.
Yes, sir.
You can take it to the bank. You can live like the devil if you want, but you're going to know some serious pain.
Yes,
and it's going to catch up with you.
Yes,
and some people go maybe a day or so, but some people go years and they just feel, you know, their self-will is swollen. And then the ultimate pain is when God will send the rebellious souls to hell. That's ultimate pain. Suffering is just part of our condition here in this life. I want to read this passage here in 1 Peter, and I need you to go with me there. Lord, we're just so grateful to be in your presence and to know you. And I pray that you'll make our worship experience by way of the word transformative. We can't do this. We're insufficient. It's a work of the Spirit.
Yes, sir.
So precious Spirit of God, be our teacher.
Thank you, Lord.
And do use this weak vessel and speak through me, I pray. Grant wisdom, grant light, grant guidance. And I do thank you again for your Son, the Lord Jesus, the absolutely adorable living God.
Yes, sir.
How we adore you. God, I thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
For your Son, Jesus,
yes.
In whose name we pray.
I
hope and pray that you'll take these passages. In fact, you know, I'm looking at 24 verses, and I did my best to sort of summarize some of the thoughts that were in those verses. Can you imagine how long it would take me to get through suffering? If I had, you know, if we were going to preach through all of these passages, it's an incredible, maybe some of you may be led to do a biblical theological study of suffering from a biblical perspective.
Yes,
I would encourage you to do that, that you and I as believers, what do we believe? Are you a believer?
Yes.
What do you believe? See, when we say we're believers, what we're basically saying is that we are orienting our understanding of reality to the text of Scripture, which makes each of us, as much as you might resist it, but it's the truth. You and I both, all of us, need to learn to be theologians.
Amen. Yes, sir.
What is a theologian? Somebody who what? Studies what? God.
Amen.
To study God. Are you studying God?
Yeah.
Oh my.
Amen.
Oh my. You ought to be. And so I just want to encourage you, please take some time and in your way, spend some time with God and see if he doesn't speak through these passages of Scripture on suffering. Some of them we're going to use them in the coming days, but we're not going to use all of them. But some of them we're going to sort of pull into our study. What we're doing, we're trying to develop a theology of suffering, an understanding of suffering from God's perspective. And I want to reiterate something I said last time I was here preaching, is that when we're talking about suffering, I think I itemize a number of ways in which we suffer. For instance, there is suffering, spiritual suffering. And we each are victims of our own sin, and we suffer because of that.
Yes,
in fact, here's a prophetic statement that concerns every one of us, every one of us in this room, every one of us in this room. You hear me? And this is not false prophecy. And guess what? I didn't have to get it out of the ether world, or I read it in Scripture. But here it is. It's prophetic. Every one of us in this room, if Jesus doesn't rapture us, we're going to die.
Amen.
Is that true?
Amen.
Am I in the book? Oh, it's in the book, beloved. That's a reality that every one of us is facing. That every one of us is facing death. And why? Because of sin.
Amen.
The Word of God says the soul that sins will surely die. We're going to die, beloved. So death is inevitable for all of us. So there is this idea of spiritual suffering. There is this idea of social and human suffering. This, by the way, is on the back of the outline that I gave you a few weeks ago as well. I hope you still have it, but this idea of social and human suffering, it's sinful actions. Think about what's happening in our world. Think about what's happening in our world. Now, I can't speak for you, but for me, it says if we're about ready to go off a cliff. It looks like nobody has answers, the answer for what's wrong with our world. Nobody. And I shouldn't say nobody, because we do, beloved, but I'm saying those that are out there in the would-be leadership, whether political or otherwise, social leaders, they're talking a lot of blah, 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 blah. I get so tired of blah, 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 blah. When you're feeding on Scripture, you want what? Substance. I want truth. And the social problems that are out there, man, they're just begging, crying out for resolution. And that resolution and solution is found only in Jesus Christ. He's our only hope.
Amen.
And thankfully, we know that he's coming back to fix it.
Yes, sir.
And he is the fix. And not Washington, and not somebody running for the White House. There's emotional suffering. Personal battles with despair and depression. Mental suffering caused by chemical imbalances in the brain. And many people suffer emotional and mental health issues because of mental or other chemical imbalances. It's suffering, physical suffering. It's caused by our fallen state, sickness, got cancer. Where did that come from? Well, it's embedded in my body. Because I have a fallen nature. And it's corrupted somehow or another, and every one of us are going to die. And we don't choose disease. We can really encourage it. I mean, there are some things we can hasten it upon ourselves, but physical suffering is caused by our fallen state, which brings me to this little, let me throw this in there. If Jesus had not died on the cross, he would what? He would live forever.
Yes, he would.
Why? Because he didn't have the sin nature in him.
Amen.
There's natural suffering, calamities, and tsunamis, earthquakes, landslides, floods, epidemics, Zika, Ebola, bubonic. Where's all this stuff come? It's suffering.
Amen.
We're living in a realm called Earth where we suffer.
Yes, sir.
And then there is this supernatural intervention of suffering, satanic suffering caused directly by Satan. Think of Job, where God gave Satan permission to test Job by way of suffering. And then finally there is this vicarious suffering that stands out in a way and different from every other form of suffering. Vicarious suffering is where Christ died for us. That's what vicar, or to be a to vicariously die, means to step into somebody's place. The Pope is called the vicar of Christ, unfortunately. He's supposed to be in Christ's place. But I want you to know, if you're a genuine believer, you and I are representatives of Jesus Christ. If we are living, again, according to the scripture. But this idea of vicarious suffering, and that's what brings us here. Follow with me here in this passage. This idea of suffering for others. Jesus died for us vicariously. And what do you think he expects out of us? See, he suffered for us. Listen to what Peter says. The elders, I'm in 1 Peter chapter 5, the elders who are among you, I exhort. I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Peter says, I'm a witness of his sufferings, but I am also a partaker of his glory. This concept of suffering and glory is in many of these passages that you'll see. Suffering and glory, that God ties glory, he ties it to suffering. A lot of people, believers, will not have glory because they're not willing to what?
Suffer.
In a vicarious suffering. Peter says, I've suffered, or I've witnessed his sufferings, and also I'm a partaker of the glory, which implies as well he suffered for Christ. And without question, Peter suffered. In fact, he suffered a martyr's death, but suffered even before that. Listen to what he says. As a elder himself, he says, he's writing to other elders. He says to the other elders, shepherd the flock of God, which is among you, serving as overseers. That word overseer is the Greek word episkopos. And in some of your English translations, you'll see the word bishop, serving as bishops. A bishop is someone who oversees the work of God. And who are these that are overseeing the work of God? The elders. So an elder is a shepherd who oversees. And he does that not by compulsion, but willingly. In fact, in this text, we see more than one elder. So what we believe here is that the church should be run by plurality of pastors. Do you see that in chapter 1, verse 1? The second word, elders, is plural. Do you see that? The elders who are among you. Church is designed to run by a plurality of elders. And what should they do? Oversee and shepherd, not by compulsion, but willingly, not by dishonest gain, but eagerly, not as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. Examples to the flock. See, leadership is more than me just standing here and articulating words about the Word of God. Leadership is about being an example of what we're teaching and preaching. I recently saw L.A. preachers. Any of you ever seen that? What an absolute perversion of biblical leadership. These L.A. preachers bask in glory in all of their opulence. And it sort of ties into this idea of the prosperity gospel that the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he died, he suffered so that you can be rich and have everything you want. And that again is such a perversion of the gospel. The gospel is a gospel that clearly demonstrates that Christ died, suffered, and died for us.
Amen.
Not so that we can be rich in this world's materials. It's such a lie. It's a lie.
Amen.
It perverts the concept of suffering.
Amen.
It perverts the concept of giving yourself of the path to following Jesus as being a disciple, a follower. It perverts this idea.
Amen.
Of following him into suffering. And so we have churches, we have pastors and leaders and people in churches that are pursuing riches and thinking that that's what God has called them to do. And it is a perversion of the gospel.
Amen.
When you look at Christ on that cross, you don't see materialism. You don't see gross inordinate affection for and lust for things of the world. No, you see just the opposite.
Amen.
That he was willing to forego. In fact, the Bible says in Philippians that he, though he were God, yet for our sakes, vicarious, he became what? A man. What did he do? He walked away from his true riches.
Amen.
This stuff down here isn't true riches. It's going to pass away. But he walked away from his glory and became a poor carpenter. What a picture. What a picture. And Peter, look at what he says here. Follow with me. He tells the elders, be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away.
Hallelujah.
Elders, suffer. There is a crown of what? Glory. Listen in verse 5. Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders.
Yes, sir.
Can I read that again?
Read it again.
Likewise, you younger people, submit yourselves to your elders. Yes, all of you be submissive, what? To one another, and be clothed with humility. For God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. See, one of the prosperity, all it does is puff people up.
Amen.
People start comparing themselves with other people, and bigger the car, where's yours? And then a lot of people who have no capacity for getting that stuff. And this is amazing that they make others feel less than because they can't
Amen.
Live at that level of excess. And that's like an exclusion that you can't have the gospel of prosperity unless you can get this stuff. That's such a perversion.
Amen.
Jesus said, whosoever will, let him come.
Yeah.
And the prosperity gospel is about those who have it. But he says, look, submit yourselves to one another. Be clothed in humility. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble.
Hallelujah.
And finally, verse 6.
Come on.
Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, because he cares for you. Just want to tell you once again, this book was written by Peter, and he's writing it to believers who have been scattered all over Asia Minor. In fact, guess where some of them are in this text. Look at the text. Look, chapter 1. Turn with me to chapter 1 and verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims.
Yes, sir.
The word there is diaspora, to be scattered.
Yes.
Those who are traveling abroad. Mm. Well, they didn't voluntarily decide to move. They were chased out of Jerusalem and out of Antioch because of persecution, because of their faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But he calls them pilgrims. He calls them the diaspora, those who are moving now. And he says, those of you who are dispersed in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia. And guess where those places are located? Modern day Turkey. Isn't that amazing? Modern day Turkey. And today in Turkey, believers are underground for this very reason, because there's so much persecution even today. But the idea that Peter writes this book to those who are being persecuted, suffering for Jesus. And I really do want to hone in on this clear. I want to make this clear. I know I talked about this idea of all these other forms of suffering, and particularly physical suffering. But I want you to know that physical suffering, when I'm talking about suffering and that which brings glory to God, that which will transfer into from suffering for Christ to glory with Christ. It's not, my cancer is not going to get me any crowns. See, because my cancer is tied to my fallen nature. I'm suffering cancer and diabetes and all the other crazy stuff that happens in bodies when we get old. We suffer. But that's not what we're talking about, to suffer for Christ. In other words, we sometimes have mistakenly thought that my cross that I'm bearing is my cancer. No, that's not a cross. What the scripture teaches about a cross is that, number one, you have to voluntarily decide to pick it up. And I did not get in a line for cancer. I didn't say, sign me up. No, Jesus said, if you're going to be my disciple, you need to go find your cross. See, the cross is a death instrument.
Yes, it is.
It's an instrument of death. And what's it about?
Yes.
It's about killing that swollen self-will.
Come on.
Jesus says you got to put yourself, die what? Daily. Put it to death. See, now that is what he's looking at. And to help us to put that carnal, swollen, self-willed nature, you know what God does? God permits physical suffering.
Amen.
The physical suffering will help us develop into a godly mentality, which then the godly mentality leads to God's glory. But it's not the cancer. That's not the cross. So it's different. That kind of suffering is not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about here is this idea of vicarious suffering, choosing to suffer for Christ. And so when Peter says, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. I'm back in chapter 5. I believe he's telling them, that you and I, in our suffering for Jesus, need to be humble. Because we can get very resistant. We just don't like people shunning us. We don't like people talking and whispering about us. I was on the plane coming back. I told you about my episode the last time. I prayed. I asked God. I said, God, I want to know, how should I witness to this man? He didn't know what I was praying about. But before I could witness, the stewardess came and took me up to first class.
Amen.
Yeah. And I got the chance to witness to the gentleman in first class. So the person he wanted me to witness to was sitting there in first class. This time, as I'm sitting there, I'm reading this book called, goodness help me, Lord. Phew. That's it. Oh, thank you. See, it's yeah. We'll call it the book. But it's an excellent book because the writers are talking about these essays. They're talking about the idea of apologetics. How we need to answer to this culture. How we speak to the world as believers. Great essays about this idea of you and I as believers. Having the wherewithal, the sense that we're responsible, we're custodians of truth, and that we're to proclaim the gospel to this culture. That's why we're alive. And so as I'm reading this and I'm sitting there, and Tracy's with me, and we're sitting there, and the stewardess comes along, and she saw me reading that, and she said, "Are you a pastor?" I said, yeah, I sure am. Now, I was engrossed in my reading, and she went on to say how she and her husband are working in church and whatnot, and I just happened to notice, and she's standing here, and I just happened to notice over across on the other side of the aisle, and this person was sort of looking down with this scowl in you know, this frown in their eyes as I'm sharing my love for God, sharing my love for Jesus. In fact, I had this new hat that this friend of mine at Cancer Treatment Center gave me. It said on the hat, "Amazing Grace, I love Jesus," and the frown, and I could tell, and I don't know if you sense that. Sometimes when you're sharing Christ, you're talking about Jesus, and you're in the midst of people who are just so adamantly opposed to the idea of the authority and the supremacy of Jesus Christ, they're going to let you know it. See, it wasn't enough. He could have been just satisfied, you know, that's theirs. But no, he just wanted to make sure I got it. You know, this look, this sense of rejection of the truth, and all I'm saying is that a lot of times we've got to get past the fear of rejection. If you're going to suffer for Christ, you can't worry about what people are going to say and what they're going to do. And really, I mean, one, who are they? Who are they? They don't have a heaven to keep you out of, and they don't have a hell to send you to.
Yes, sir.
No, no. Submit yourself to God's authority. Humble yourselves under the he calls it the mighty hand of God. In my notes here, I want you to know he's calling us to submit ourselves to the sovereignty of God in suffering.
Yes, sir.
for Christ. Amen. What? God is sovereign. Let me back it up. Look. He says submit to God. That means you and I need to make some adjustments in terms of how we view suffering. In fact, we need to adjust our understanding of how we view the world. Because I would suggest to you that we as believers, we're constantly under a barrage to look at this world as the world sees itself. And the world sees itself as secular. What is secularism? Secularism says, I don't need God.
Amen.
And they keep trying to impose on us that secular thinking. And I'm telling you, beloved, it's so embedded in all of the messaging, all of the movies, all of the commercials, all of the newspaper, all of the media. It is, we don't need. When's the last time you saw anybody in trouble and decide, you know what, and talk about, I need God to deliver? When's the last time you saw a movie and it talked about God delivering? No, it's about man. We don't need God. We can handle this. And see, now the sad part is that saturation finds its way into our spirits. We drink from the fountain of secularism. And how does it show itself up? Let me test you. When was the last time you spent some time reading the Word of God?
Amen.
When's the last time you sat in a Bible study? When's the last time you prayed with other saints? When's the last? See, what is it? See, what I'm suggesting to you is that we've embraced secularism because we're not in pursuit of God. And he calls them. See, that is one of the problems for us in terms of suffering. He says, submit to it. What? He is sovereign. God is God. He's in control. Think with me. I want to share this with you. Think about this. It's about perspective. Humble yourselves under the almighty, sovereign hand of God. See, when we suffer, three questions are going to come up. And depending upon how you answer this will depend upon how you respond to suffering. The first question, when we suffer for Christ, think about this. Lord, I'm telling people about you and all I get is a lot of slack. What's up with that? And some of us would just be tempted to say, you know what? I ain't going through that. My faith is personal. And see, that too is a secular perception of reality. No. Your faith, it's yours personally, but it's to be proclaimed publicly.
Amen.
That's what disciples of Jesus Christ do. That's what we're called upon to do, to publicly proclaim the truth about Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Three questions that you and I in our suffering need to answer. One, the first question is this idea of God's omniscience. Does God really know everything? And does he know what he's doing?
Yes, sir.
He can't know what he's doing. See, if he knew what he was doing, then why in the world do, watch this, good people suffer? That's a secular perception.
Yes, it is.
Because in reality, here it is. You ready?
Yes, sir. Come on.
You ready?
Come on.
All right. One more time. You ready?
Yes.
The truth of the matter is, nobody's good.
Amen. That's right.
See, it's this assumption that suffering is tied to whether or not we're good.
Amen.
And therefore, if God is all knowing, then there's no way he should let good people suffer. Well, who's good? God is good. Amen. And in essence, everybody else has offended God. And essentially, the reality is all of us are destined to die one way or the other.
Amen.
Now, I know it's offensive, but truth does that. Truth sets things in clear focus.
Hallelujah.
We question, God, does he know? It's like Elijah. Elijah took those false God there, whoever they were worshiping.
Yes, sir.
And he told them, look, now I want you to call out to your God.
Hallelujah.
And call out to him. Oh, they spent all day calling out to him. And he teased them, he taunted them.
Yes, he did.
You've read this, right? Now, some of you probably think, where in the world is he getting that story? You need to read scripture. See, he taunted them. He said, is he on vacation?
Amen.
See, some of us think, okay, now God, where are you? What are you? Have you gone for a trip or what? See, it's really a question of his omniscience. Does he really know everything? Then there's a second question, God's omnipotence. Okay, so he might know everything, but can he really do everything? See, it's a real question. It's a real question. When you suffer, you're doing this, Lord, I love you, and I'm going out here to tell people about Jesus, and I don't care what they say. And then as soon as somebody, I remember we were knocking on some doors over here telling people about Jesus. And we walked up on this one porch, and the lady said, I don't know who was with me, but opened the window upstairs. I was trying to introduce. She said, I was trying to introduce myself. She didn't even let me get it out. Take that stuff out of here. I don't even want. And I just want you to know, beloved,
Amen.
I was hurt. I'm serious. I was offended. I was offended. Because she rejected. It's not fun to be rejected. All I'm saying is that we've got to be willing to get past that sense of being rejected by men who resist the gospel of Jesus Christ. And sometimes in our suffering, we'll question either maybe God doesn't know, omniscient, maybe he doesn't know everything. And in his omnipotence, that's his ability. See, omniscience is his knowledge. Does he really know? The idea of his omnipotence is his ability. Really, can he really make a difference? If he can, then why in the world am I suffering?
Amen.
Why all this feedback from the world? Is he able to make a difference? Can he really manage human suffering? See, the Bible clearly declares that God knows everything and God is able. In fact, we say it all the time, to unto him who what? Who is able to do what? Exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ask. God is able.
Yes, he is.
But I'm telling you, suffering can bring you to this third question as well.
Come on,
the third question is relative to what's called omnibenevolence. That is, God is all loving. God loves humanity. He loves humanity who was created in his image, something awful. I mean, just God is crazy with his love for mankind. He just is. How do we know? Look at that cross. See, that cross says God loves you. He's love. But then, see, suffering causes us to question his affection. Does he really care? The disciples were with Jesus on a boat trying to cross Lake Gennesaret. He went down into the lower region of the boat, lower area of the boat, and went to sleep. Went to sleep. You've read that? Just checking. You ought to read it. If you haven't read it, check this out. Check it out. You need to read it. That he goes to sleep. And while he is asleep, His lake and the wind start getting into a little tussle.
Yes, sir.
The wind said, I got this. The wave says, no, I got this. They just get go and the boat is in being tossed and driven by the wind and by the waves. Jesus is asleep. You ever been there? The midst of a storm. And you just wonder. And now here's the key. They go down to wake him up. And they wake him up by asking him the very question I'm talking about. They wake him up. Jesus, wake up. Man, do you care that we're about to perish? Oh, beloved. I don't know if you have been there. But in the midst of human suffering, sometimes personal suffering, sometimes physical suffering, sometimes also around this idea of vicarious suffering, doing what's right for Jesus, and we suffer. And then we wonder, well, come on, Jesus, do you really care? And if you cared, the implication is this. If you cared, I wouldn't be suffering. They woke him up, and he said to them, he said, you have such little faith. And he rebukes them for not trusting. What were they to trust? What were they to trust? I mean, really, what were they to trust? Here you got a storm that's about, in their thinking, about ready to wreck the boat, take them under. And that's how they saw it. That's their secular perspective. Amen. That God can't handle this. And I'm telling you, beloved, life will kind of put you in bolts sometimes and have you wondering, can he really handle this? Does he really care? They woke him up and he rebuked them. He rebuked them. How could you doubt? What is he saying? He's saying, look, I'm on this boat. That's all you need to know. I'm on this boat. I don't care if I'm asleep. I don't care if I'm awake. I'm on this boat. They should have trusted that no matter what was going on, Master is on board. Nothing can happen to you if Jesus is on board. Nothing. Nothing that he doesn't permit. Oh, ye of little faith. Does he really care? I'm telling you, I don't know how many times I've run to that question. Peter says, submit to his sovereignty.
Thank you, Lord.
In our suffering.
Thank you, Lord.
I don't care what kind of suffering right now you're going through. Yes. Every bit of it, God can use it.
Thank you, Lord.
He's using it to perfect,
thank
to establish, to strengthen, and to settle us.
Thank you.
We're going to discover that as we go further in the passage. Father, we're so thankful.
Thank you, Lord.
For Jesus.
Yes, sir.
The suffering,
yes, sir,
servant.
Thank you.
Oh God. Make us like you.
Hallelujah.
Forgive us for our pompous, swollen self-will that resists your authority, that questions your sovereignty, that questions your knowledge, questions your ability, questions your affection. Hear us today.